This is the Federal Feens, broadcasting from cell block 2A, a mile below sea level in a secret CIA dungeon detention facility. We alter your breathing by waterboarding you with Brondo and tase you with statism until it warms your body to a warm, toasty, tasty 365 degrees Fahrenheit. Can you feel it, Jim? Can you feel it, Davi?
Oh, yes.
This is a very special episode of the Federal Feens. We have, what is that thing called again, Jim?
Well, we've crossed over from the parallel universe where Spock has a beard, and we have come into this universe to save these puny Freedom Feens listening people. And we're going to bring them the true spirit of the Federal Feens.
Yes, and we've had a change of heart, and we've decided that government is good, government is our savior, and without it, we would all be dead. And I want to dedicate this show to a special little kid listening in the hospital, little Mikey Dean, who fell flat on his face because he OD'd on catnip. Anyway, this is Choke Chain Lou, and I am joined by my partners in compliance, just doing their jobs, Jim, and Davi, the Window Czar. Welcome, gentlemen. Welcome.
Great to be with you.
Davi, is there a particular license that we have for this show tonight?
I think it's just important to point out that any resemblance to any real people imagined or real is purely intentional, that copying, distributing, or discussing the content of this show is strictly forbidden, and that all rights are reversed. So think for yourself, schmuck.
Very well. So anyway, government is good. Jim, tell us how government has been good to you. Tell us about how it has touched you in all those warm, fuzzy places.
Well, you know, ever since I was a kid, I liked having parents. And it's always been comforting having this, like, having a father there and a mother there to make the hard decisions for me, to take care of me, to correct me when I'm wrong. And I never outgrew that. And I still today feel like I need to feel the loving clench of government around my neck to just reassure me and let me know everything's going to be okay.
See,
so
that's
why I love the federal government.
I couldn't disagree with you more. See, I don't feel like I need those sorts of strictures, but see, I know that other people do. And so I voluntarily submit to those strictures, even though I don't need them, in order to live in a more civilized society.
Hmm. Wow. Yeah, because it's always the others that need to be watched. It's never us. You know, I have to agree with both of you, because one, I need to be controlled, and two, I think other people need to be controlled also. Therefore, I am willing to submit myself and everybody else, because we need to be controlled. Let me tell you a little something about my change of heart and leaving, you know, that whole, you know, government is bad thing. There's this website, it's called governmentisgood.com, and it looks like the purveyor of the of this wonderful, the gospel.
It's outreach material.
It's not just outreach. It's gospel. But anyway, it's by Douglas J. Amy, professor of politics at Mount Holyoke College. And on the front page, it asks, why a website defending government? Because for decades, conservatives have been demonizing and attacking government, and not enough has been done to defend it. We need to recognize that despite its problems, government plays an essential role in promoting the good life for all Americans. When we recklessly reduce and underfund this institution, we are hampering our ability to improve people's lives and effectively address our pressing social, economic, and environmental problems. And speaking of the environment, you know that if it wasn't for the EPA, all the rivers and lakes would be orange right now. Every last one of them.
That's right. Right.
So that's why government is good.
Right. People get all upset because they see one river. Okay, well, sure, one river was ruined. One river is horribly polluted with lead and other toxins, these nasty metals and toxins and horrible, you know, it's like lead and mercury and, you know, but it's just one river. Just one
it
river.
It just goes to right? show people that the get EPA all bent out of shape is underfunded. It. It just yeah, goes yeah, to exactly. show that the EPA is underfunded. We need a stronger yes. public union in the EPA. That's probably what I will bet. If you look at the actual culprits, they were not union labor, and that's why this happened.
It's a strong possibility there. Yeah. But right. But look at all the rivers. You know, do you see the headlines about all the rivers that aren't orange right now? No, you don't. They always point out the negative. Just, you know, but those EPA guys, they were just doing their jobs. You know, they were following procedures. And if it hadn't, you know, if they had had more money, they wouldn't have destroyed that one river. So, yeah.
Would we even have rivers without government?
I really don't think so, because who would have dug them out?
Well, I think we'd have them, but they would be on fire, most of them.
Yeah, like the Cuyahoga River. It's the Cuyahoga River that's caught on fire several times over the past 150 years, right? Whatever
that's
one is
one right. That's why you need the EPA. You know, keep that from happening.
Yeah, and if it wasn't for government, you know, California would be completely out of water. Instead of having to confiscate 300 farms, they'd probably have to confiscate 600. I just saw that article earlier today that I'm not sure it was 300 or 30, but anyway, the state government finding it necessary that they may need to confiscate these, move all these farmers over to the collective farms and appoint a commissar to be in charge of these farms to make sure that they keep up their production in a proper manner. But because these farms are somehow interfering with the government's ability to make sure that there's enough water, it just has to be taken.
Well, yeah, the answer makes to sense. Drought is obviously rationing.
Yes. I mean,
of course.
Had they been rationing all along, there wouldn't be a shortage. Just because you have the largest body of water on Earth right next to that state doesn't mean that, you know, that you could just waste water willy-nilly or anything like that. Just because the Navy ships are able to desalinate the seawater doesn't mean that, you know, like lower state government could be able to do that. And that's
well, you know, I mean, it's not like we don't have good examples. I mean, I look at Venezuela as a good example where those politicians had the courage to seize the farms, to seize the food warehouses, to make sure that these are now available for the people that need it, and we've got smart people in charge deciding who that is, right? Like, what would happen if nobody was doing that? It'd be anarchy.
Well, it's really just selfish to hold on to a private farm when people are hungry.
Yeah, and to top it off, those ungrateful citizens of Venezuela, that they can't be thankful for what they have, and that's why they've had several hundred protests this year and anti-government demonstrations. Just this year alone, several hundred of them. I mean, looting and pillaging the stores. I mean, my God. And I could see you doing that to private stores, but a government store? What's that about?
Yeah. No respect at all for the rule of law. It's horrible.
Oh, gosh. The rule of law is sacrosanct when it comes to government, because we all know that law, it's brought down on stone tablets from the mountaintop. I mean, yeah, sure, you know, the people in the buildings, they get their hands on it, they play with it, but it originates up on the mountaintop and comes down the stone tablets, and it gets transferred to paper, and, you know, then they do some, like, ceremonies and everything else. But I mean, without our laws, I mean, without our health care laws, where would we be? And I know there's people out there that are planning on violating our health care laws. They're not going to follow the process like they should. They're not going to fill out the paperwork and wait their turn. They're probably going to go out and purchase undocumented health care out on the black market.
That sounds dangerous.
How is that fair to the others that followed the process and did things the legal way.
Well, what that is, that's called hoarding. Okay, and they'll get cracked down on that eventually. People are going to be hoarding healthcare resources. They're going to be, you know what? I mean, we need to crack down on people that might be stockpiling Band-Aids. Okay, can you imagine that? Like people with more than one box of Band-Aids in their cupboard. Whoa, you know, the selfishness.
Well, why do you need more than a box? If you ever had a laceration that required more than a box, you ought to go and get stitches from the government hospital. So there's really never any reason, I mean, really, to have more than one or two Band-Aids.
Just selfishness.
Quite frankly, if they're using more than one or two Band-Aids, they should probably be charged for practicing medicine without a license.
Especially focusing them on someone else.
Well, that is part of our healthcare laws. Well, and even if they're duals, we all belong to the government. You know, we all belong to each other because we are the government. So, how can I go putting a Band-Aid on myself when we should be going to government to do that?
Bad, they should probably just be, they should probably just bleed out and die as to not be a burden on society, right? I mean,
yeah, but that's not their decision to make. You need a panel of people to make all the proper economic calculations before you make a decision like that.
Right. There should be a review by the death panel to decide if that person is worthy of more than two Band-Aids.
Please, the life panel.
The life
panel. Yeah, we don't have death panels anymore. We call them something else. And that's... That's very inappropriate, inflammatory language. And if you're going to say things like that, it would be nice if you gave a trigger warning first, because there are some sensitive people out there that are, they just don't have the constitution for, that sort of language. Now say you're sorry.
You have to think of the people who have been affected by death and are traumatized by it before you go spouting off words like that.
True. I apologize.
Thank you. And we'll be back right after this trip to the state store and washing our mouths out with lava.
You're listening to The Freedom Feens, an invigorating alternative to those other shows.
Are you tired of your taxes funding endless occupations around the world? Antiwar.com is run by people who understand that wars abroad become wars at home, wars on our freedoms. Antiwar.com is dedicated to bringing you the latest in news, views, interviews, and reviews from the top movers and shakers in the anti-occupation movement. Antiwar.com has it all, from thorough foreign policy analysis to interviews with whistleblowers who used to run the military-industrial complex. Antiwar, pro-free market. That's Antiwar.com.
Going back to why government is good and why the law is sacred, there's a section in here called the Forgotten Achievements of Government, and you'll find that in the section called Why Government is Good. And the importance of laws, and not just the law, but our laws, like our healthcare laws, our immigration laws, and our segregation laws, which were our laws until they were repealed. As far as the forgotten achievements of government go, it took a big, powerful government to repeal those sacred segregation laws. At least they were sacred until they were repealed. And clearly the reason that those segregation laws were implemented was because of weak, powerless government. And I'm just befuddled that a weak, powerless government would even dare do something like that. And thank God that we had a big government to come along and right that wrong. I mean, those segregation laws were over 100 years old.
Well, I mean, that's why it's so important to have a federal government over the state governments, because if you allow state governments autonomy, it's essentially just anarchy but bigger, right? Like you need a government for governments to keep them from from harming people.
Yeah, and that is the value of the Constitution. Because prior to the ratification of the Constitution, there were actually 13 separate nations. And that, you know, left on their own, that, you know, they would have gone to war. They needed somebody to settle disputes, keep them from going to war with each other, and, you know, make sure that trade was fair and regular and everything else. So, as a matter of fact, that's a good argument for world government. Because maybe national governments just can't do it because there's a lot of disputes and there's certainly a lot of wars. So why not one world government, and, you know, let the federal, state, and local governments, you know, deal with, like, roads and stuff like that.
But right, have a central power at the top commanding everyone. It would be so orderly. It would be so peaceful.
It would be so New World orderly.
Yeah,
that would be awesome.
You know, and we might even have to go like a solar system wide or galactic government eventually. You know, possibly with some kind of like Death Star that could move around the galaxy and take care of those rebel planets if they did crop up. That sounds like the next logical step to me.
Definitely. I was actually pretty upset by the depiction of the Death Star in Star Wars, because anybody who understands nuclear options understands the reason to have a weapon that large is so that you don't have to use it.
Well, yeah. Exactly. And when you take out something like Alderaan or Nagasaki, it's just to set, you know, it's so you don't have to blow up the rest of the galaxy, right?
Right.
Right. You have to demonstrate it. Right? Or people don't think it's real. But that's just, it's unfortunate, but these things, you just have to do that so everybody gets in line, and it saves lives in the end.
Well, I'm not going to say that Alderaan and Nagasaki didn't deserve it, but obviously the people in the Old Republic, you know, like the Imperial Senate and everything, obviously the wrong people were in charge, and maybe the people of that galaxy should have voted a little bit harder.
And sure, they should have made it mandatory.
Yeah. And one other thing that I want to throw in, X-Wing fighter fuel can't melt steel beams. We know this. Now, one of my favorite candidates for the 2016 election, and believe you me, they're all my favorites, but this one, maybe just a little bit more favorite than the rest. Jim, you were telling me about this. I got really excited about it. Bernie Sanders has proposed a new law. Could you share that with us?
Well, you know, Bernie Sanders, he's probably one of the most brilliant politicians of our day. He has this idea, and he's working on passing a law that makes, first of all, it's something, he's starting out easy, making Election Day a federal holiday, right? Because the first thing you want to do is make sure that everybody who's works for the government can vote, okay? Because you know they're going to be voting for more government. So this is really going to help us out when that happens. Make it as easy as possible for everybody that is part of our federal family to vote more easily. It's also going to make it automatic voter registration when you turn 18. I think that's a great idea.
And it's going to be mandatory, right?
Oh, of course.
Because there's nothing better than holidays and mandatory.
Oh, I love hearing that word mandatory.
It will be right back.
You don't want to deprive people of your opinion.
Freedom Fiends with Michael Dean. This is what radio sounds like now.
When you shop online, please do it through the Freedom Fiends Amazon link over on the right side of freedomfiends.com. It won't cost you any extra, and the Fiends will get a little taste from Amazon, and Amazon will save you the danger of drive-by stabbings at your local mall. Amazon sells pretty much everything you can buy on this earth, except for guns and weed. But they do sell the DVD Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. So get that for your gun-hating stoner brother or neocon gun nut dad. They'll thank you for it. That's freedomfiends.com. Freedom, Foxtrot, Echo, November, Sierra.com.
This voices of Federal Fiends. You know, I wish we had some more patriotic bumper music to play, but we just got that libertarianist rock and roll punk rock stuff. This is Choke Chain Lou, and I am joined by Just Doing Their Jobs Jim and Davi The Window Czar. And in the last segment, we were talking about the joys of voting. And I really love voting, and I'm glad that super soon-to-be President Bernie Sanders wants to make it a federal holiday and mandatory, because I think it's just really great that I get to vote on my neighbor's rights and money, you know, what they'll be allowed to do, and they get to vote on what I'll be allowed to do also. But even more, I get to spend their money without having to work for it. And that is just so awesome. Isn't that awesome, boys?
Sure. Well, you know, there's a collective wisdom in voting, you know, where when we get together, like individually, we're all idiots. But when we get together and aggregate our idiocy, it becomes brilliance. Okay. And that's the magic of democracy. So that's why I love it. I think it's wonderful.
Yeah. I mean, I think of mandatory voting, I think of essentially like mandatory schooling. If you don't force kids to learn, they'll never learn the joy of learning. So you have to force them to start them out. And then once they get the hang of it, you know, you can let them graduate and go out on their own. So it's the same with voting. You have to force people to vote. You have to make it mandatory so that they can really feel, you know, the joy of voting. And then they can, you know, do it themselves.
Well, and it's also the joy of the mandate itself, the comfort of having a structured environment, I think is wonderful for many people. So
it also frees you from the anxiety of deciding whether or not to vote.
Right. It's truly liberating.
I have to respectfully disagree with you on just one tiny bit of what you just said there, Window Czar. No, they can't really go out on their own and be unsupervised. I'm sorry. It just can't be. But I think one of the great things is that the schools are run by the government, and I'm glad that they teach people to love government. And I wish they'd really teach people a little bit more about voting and specifically how to vote. I mean, I know they do that right now, but I don't think they're doing enough of it, because there's, like, I don't know, probably more than half of the eligible voters just decline to go out and drop their grain of sand on the beach and make their mark. And it's sad. It's kind of shameful. Yeah.
It's really sad. And it's kind of heartbreaking to our federal family members, because you know what, it's almost like these people don't care. So I think we need to force them to vote so that our federal family members feel the love, feel that mandatory love.
Yeah. And not just force them to vote, right. And Jim, you came up with a story that it is very disheartening, because these people had an opportunity to vote the right way and they went the wrong way. Could you share that with us?
Yeah, well, this is a story about people that had jury duty. And it was a city versus Dr. George Lohman, a resident of Trinity Estates.
Excuse me a second. And jury duty is one of the best, most enjoyable sacraments of government.
Right.
Please continue. Right.
And it is mandatory. This guy was given 30 misdemeanor charges for violating the city's animal at large ordinance for peacocks that roamed the neighborhood. Okay, so this guy allowed 30 peacocks to just completely roam the neighborhood and without restraint. Okay,
no leash.
Now, yeah, no leashes. No leashes for these peacocks. So the jury had an opportunity to send a strong message and to protect the community from these leashless peacocks, but they didn't. The jury said not guilty, and they cleared this man of all 19 charges that he was facing.
Well, I think that, I mean, if anything, that goes to show that we can't leave jury duty to the layman. We really need a licensed jury pool where people have to meet some basic standard of legal education before they're allowed to make legal decisions. And if we can't have a limited licensed pool, then we need to make some sort of jury education mandatory for everyone.
Yeah, I like the sound of that. And I mean, or just if people just really, you know, understood how important the system was, they wouldn't need to be told to vote guilty. When you're on jury duty, you just vote guilty because, let's face it, you're not going to be on trial if you're not guilty of something, right? Everybody's guilty of something. So do your duty. You know, you have this joy. You even get paid like $5 a day, okay? You know, which to me seems extremely generous. Just go in there, say guilty, and get it over with. Move on to the next customer. That's what I think people should do.
I'm curious as to whether the judge properly instructed the jury. I know in the neighboring state of Wisconsin, when the judge gives jury instruction, the judge will say, you know, you have to follow the law 100%. Leave your opinions, your conscience, and your morality at the door, and just follow the law and find them guilty.
I don't care what the reasoning is. If you vote not guilty, you're really impugning the character of the noble officers that arrested the suspect.
And the prosecutor.
Yeah. And the prosecutor. And let's face it, the police have a very tough job. Not just the police, but our police. Our police have a very tough job. So if they can't get all the evidence in line because of all the criminals are out there, and if they make some mistakes every now and again, just give them the benefit of the doubt. Because, we know they're not, you know, just mortal humans or anything like that, but it is still a tough job being our police because we're so bad right. And we keep them so busy.
Right. And, you know, and let's face it, it's better that a few innocent people might go to jail than to let one guilty person go free. Okay. We just can't allow that.
Oh, heaven forbid. I mean, could you imagine how dangerous it would be if there was like one guilty person out there? You know, like if one person that got caught with like, I don't know, maybe like a half a gram of marijuana, and if they were out on the streets, do you know how dangerous that would be to the rest of the world? But half a gram of marijuana. I mean, that's how all those people died in Cambodia, the Soviet Union, Germany in the 1930s and 40s. I mean, God, man, think of the children.
Definitely.
I mean, I don't know anything about weights and measures, but as I understand it, people who smoke the marijuana, they pass it to other people, which means one person with marijuana could potentially be a whole group of people on marijuana.
And not to mention the germs that are on the marijuana, you know, thingamabob as they're passing it around. And thank God for Ben Carson and his mandatory vaccines. Because granted, these people deserve whatever diseases they catch from each other, but maybe a vaccine could save some lives.
Well, just because they deserve it doesn't mean that we can't protect them from it.
Right. Right, and I mean, that is the goal, but if somebody has to be sacrificed.
That's ultimately why they need to be incarcerated anyway, to protect them from themselves.
Yes. Oh, and by the way, I just looked up on the internet, a half a gram is like huge. I mean, it's like, you know, stretch your arms out as far as you can, and that's how like tall, wide, and thick it is. That's a half gram. Now, Davi, you had an interesting story that your grandmother was on jury duty, but she did the right thing.
Well, so this is different because the defendant was a police officer, and I think that we have to make special accommodations for police officers.
They should never be defendants.
One of our police officers.
So what happened was there was an altercation with some thug, and this officer, you know, he gave him the wood shampoo as like you do, and it was unclear whether or not this was warranted. And after an internal investigation, I realized these things can be thorough. They decided that ultimately it should be put to a jury, and the officer was technically in the wrong, according to the letter of the law. My grandmother felt that because the thug swore, he used profanity at the officer, that he was justified in bludgeoning this man, and so she voted not guilty out of her conscience and let the officer off. And it's just
common human decency to let a cop get off. I mean, all he did was bludgeon a man, right? I mean,
who had used profanity? Yeah.
Right.
Is he supposed to just let people say whatever they want?
What if cops just let people say whatever they wanted to say, right? Oh, that'd be anarchy.
And it would again be like, how many children would have heard this man use the word that he used that I can't even say? So the officer was protecting these children from learning this word, and you know, he wasn't just acting out of anger for his own insult. It was the badge that was insulted. See, that's the point, is you can insult the man, but you can't insult the office, right?
Because that insults all of us, because he's our police, right? He represents us.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it's a slight against one is a slight against all. As a matter of fact, that horrible miscreant that uttered those profanities actually insulted himself.
Whoa.
Yeah. And the best part is, you know, he wasn't actually assaulted by that fine police officer. He beat himself up because we are the government. So, oh, by the way, I just got a comment from somebody on Facebook. They're really loving this episode because of all the mad scientists that we're dropping and how we're spreading all this wonderful gospel of government. So I just wanted to share that with you. Yes, yes, definitely. Now, Jim, you take part in an outreach to jurors, and sure. you attempt to counteract the jury tamperers, right?
Oh yeah, yeah. Well, and this is something that anybody can do, and I just consider part of my civic duty. I go to courthouses from time to time, and I pass out pamphlets, and I inform jurors about their right to vote their conscience and say guilty. No matter what the facts of the case may be, if you think that person deserves punishment, you can say guilty. And this is this power. It goes back to the Magna Carta. It's been a cornerstone of our judicial system for centuries, and it's really important that people understand not just their right, but their duty.
Some of his weird friends, and yes, we're broadcasting this into space.
Are you sick of government lackeys who say you didn't build that? Are you tired of elitists like Barack Obama and Al Gore taking credit for the web while trying to take over the web? Are you disgusted by experts whose concept of the internet is that it's a series of tubes? Take back the free market of computing by encouraging software developers to adopt the BIPCOT NoGov license. The BIPCOT NoGov license allows any use or modification except by governments. Go to BIPCOT.org. That's Bravo, India, Papa, Charlie, Oscar, Tango.org.
Very patriotic, and you're listening to the Federal Feens. This is not longer leash Lou, choke chain Lou, and I am joined by Just Doing Their Jobs Jim and Davi The Window Czar. And I want to thank you for your service, Just Doing Their Jobs Jim, because you go out and you try to counteract those jury tamperers. And there was recently a story, I believe it was in, where was it, Colorado, or was it St. Louis or something like that, where some jury tamperers were arrested?
Yeah, that was in Denver. In Denver, some people, you know, probably some hippies. I don't know for sure, but I'm just imagining that they're hippies.
Probably taking the pots, too.
Oh, definitely. They go to what they were doing is going to these courthouses and letting the public know that jurors have a right to say not guilty. Okay, now technically that's true. Okay, technically a juror could say, you know, it's one of the flaws in the system. It's there. You know,
segregation laws.
Yeah.
It takes time to perfect the system.
Right. But so technically, a juror can say not guilty if they think the law is wrong. But what a horrible, horrible message to give people. Now, thankfully, the authority figures in Denver saw what was going on, and they immediately swooped in and took these hippies into custody. And because they this information, you know, while technically, you know, it's not illegal, it's obviously wrong. And so they did, you know, they did the right thing by shutting down this operation and sending a strong message to the jurors. Say, look, your duty is to convict. We have a system. They spent a lot of money on this system, too. This judicial system costs a pretty penny. Have you seen these buildings and the salaries and the pensions and the buffets? It's enormous. Okay, the complimentary haircuts. Okay, it's and then people go in and say not guilty. Like, what a giant waste of money. Okay, so that's why, you know, as I was I kind of talked over the break, but why I like to go to a courthouse and inform people that they have a right to say guilty, regardless of the facts of a crime. If they think someone deserves punishment, it's not just their right, it's their duty to punish. It's their duty to send a strong message and to keep our community safe.
Yeah, because sometimes the facts of the case don't add up, but you can tell by looking at the guy that he's guilty of something.
Yeah, yeah, and he might have a tattoo.
Or a ponytail, or heaven forbid, a beard.
You know. Yeah.
So and come on. Do you think the cops are just going to pick somebody up off the street for no reason? I understand that they're under pressure to clear cases, but that doesn't mean that they, you know, don't do their due diligence on every single investigation.
They're just doing their jobs.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, and you know what, with all that money that it costs for these wonderful courthouses, these houses of justice, or I should say houses of law, but for all the money that we spend, I'm going to go out, I'm going to get another federal job and maybe a local government job too, because I need to pay more taxes. This stuff's not going to support itself on its own. It's not like, you know, unicorns are going to fly down and drop money on these courthouses. We have to do more. We have to do our part.
Well, and you know, here's a story that I just saw from, now, you know, liberal Massachusetts again. Okay.
God.
They have this town, there's this town in Massachusetts where the police chief said that his officers were no longer going to arrest drug users who approached them seeking help. Okay. Now, of course, police are often approached by drug users seeking help, right? That's just a normal part of being a cop.
I'm confused. They're asking to be arrested, aren't they?
Well, that's what you would think, right? But they, instead of arresting these people, over 100 people, instead of going to prison, were given drug treatment assistance.
Okay? Oh, treatment's a myth.
Oh.
They owe a debt to society.
They could be filling jail cells right now, and instead they're helping them get over drug addiction. This is horrible. I don't understand it. Think of the jobs that have been lost.
Absolutely. Some poor prison workers out of a job because of this.
And it's not just the prison workers and the people that provide the food and the uniforms and the toilet paper. It's probation officers later, right?
And social workers.
Yeah.
And when we come back from this trip to the state-run store, we're going to tell you why we love the war on drugs.
Hey, there's some Squizzcar Squiggles from Death Clocks. And you are listening to the Freedoms Fiends on the, you know, the radios. And I guess I says worms now, so there you go.
Tired of those old Freedom Fiends buttons? Well, the Freedom Fiends have new button designs.
As always, it's only $10 for 10 buttons, and you'll get these nifty designs. Buy sheep, for sheep, on sheep.
State speech is hate speech.
Two designs for Guns and Weed, the Road to Freedom.
Three designs for Fiend Phone.
Pipcot No Gov.
A Freedom Fiends worms button.
And ask me about my worms.
go to freedomfiends.com and click on the link at the top that says buttons.
And now they're bigger buttons.
They used to be 1 1/4 inch. Now they're 1 3/4 inch. Dan, they're bigger buttons.
What does freedom mean? Tune in to LRN.FM to find out. LRN.FM is the Liberty Radio Network, a collection of live talk radio and podcasts, all coming from a principled pro-liberty perspective. LRN.FM show hosts aren't left, right, or conspiracy kooks. You can tune in 24/7 to LRN.FM via your phone, computer, satellite, and more. Listen free anytime at LRN.FM. That's LRN.FM.
This show survives on donations from fiends like you. We put that money back into our show and Liberty Outreach and donate most our ad space to Liberty organizations that make a difference. We're also a teaching hospital, educating the next generation of Liberty talkers on the skills needed to keep the radio flame of truth burning into the future. Put your money where your heart is and make a donation of any amount to the Freedom Feens. Please go to freedomfiends.com and click on the spinning coin on any post.
Hi there, this is Jimmy Russell, and you're listening to The Federal Fiends, the worst form of entertainment except for all the others. What you're about to hear is real. Only the facts have been changed to prosecute the innocent. The voices you hear are not actors, they are co-hosts on an actual radio show. The Federal Fiends denies all liability for the content of The Federal Fiends and for all consequences of any actions taken on the basis of the entertainment provided. Any resemblance to any people, real or imagined, is purely intentional. Copying, distributing, discussing the contents of this show is strictly forbidden, and all rights are reversed. I'm here with Choke Chain Lou, Just Following Orders Jim, and Davi The Window Czar. Hey guys, how are your Jimmies feeling tonight?
Russell. Oh man.
My Jimmies have been touched improperly. And by the way, the Federal Fiends is covered by a BIPCOT all government license. All government, all the time. And and government is good. Oh, and by the way, I have our first public service announcement of the night. Is your cat caught in a tree? Put down that ladder. You can't do that yourself, nor should you. Call the local police and fire department. Call the local police and fire department. They have the proper equipment and training to handle such emergencies. Note, repeat offenses will be handled by animal control and may include the death penalty. This public service announcement has been brought to you by the Government is a God Foundation. And in the end of the last hour, Jim, you were telling us a very sad story out of Massachusetts, how compassion has been taken advantage of. Could you please tell us, bring us back to what those miscreants were doing and give us a full story on that.
Right. Well, this is like any town in Massachusetts, drug use is a huge problem. There's junkies just, walking the streets everywhere. It's just a terrible, terrible place for drug addiction. And now, instead of doing the right thing, which would be to take these drug addicts off the street, put them in a jail cell where they belong, where they can generate revenue, okay? You take somebody that's a no-good hippie, and you can turn them into a revenue-generating creature by putting them in a jail cell, okay? Now, this is something that we've proven time and time again works. It creates all kinds of prosperity, not just for the jailers, not just for the people that are supplying it, not just for the counselors, not just for the guards and the ammunition and the barbed wire makers, but then they get out, there's parole officers and probation officers, and then there's the people that get to arrest them again and bring them back to jail as repeat offenders. This is a whole system we've worked out, and it works. Yeah,
don't forget, recidivism is just repeat business.
Right. This is just everybody wants repeat business. It's normal. So we've established that the system works, and these people in this town of Massachusetts said, whoa, wait a minute. We're gonna just pass up all this good stuff, and we're gonna help these people with their drug addiction. That's like saying it's like saying you work at McDonald's, okay, and somebody comes in and tries to order 6 Big Macs, and you're like, here, no, here's your Weight Watchers plan. What kind of an idiot at McDonald's would do that? I don't understand it. I don't understand it.
I'm just befuddled because everybody knows that recidivism is just another name for residual income. You know, it's like selling an insurance policy and getting renewal commissions on it. I mean, come on. I mean, obviously, these
it's the way it should be.
Yeah, but these people didn't pay attention in the government schools, and they didn't learn how to vote properly, so they wound up taking the pots and the coffee and all the other dangerous drugs, and now look at them. I mean, they should be in jail. I mean, they should be rotting and paying their debt to society, even though society picks up the tab for that debt. But
now, I am torn because it was police officers that made this decision. And normally I would never question the decision of a police officer. As far as I'm concerned, they're as close to infallible as a mere mortal can be. So, but yet, here with this weird dilemma, someone maybe got to them and corrupted them somehow.
Is it possible that members of the drug cartel could have infiltrated the police department and changed the policy from within?
Bite your tongue.
What if we're looking at a much larger, like, organized criminal conspiracy?
No, I don't think it would be the drug cartels because
Bite your tongue.
The drug cartels, they make a lot of money off the status quo as before. Right. By putting these addicts in cages and whatnot, that maintains a high level of demand for the product.
Well, then it's so terrorists.
Yeah.
I think you should bite your tongue because our police would never be bought off by drug cartels.
Oh, I'm not saying they're bought off. I'm saying they're infiltrated.
No, because the police do thorough background investigations when they hire other police, and there's absolutely no way that somebody with shady connections could ever get in there.
Oh, okay.
Right.
Well, I'm glad that that's good to hear. I feel much better.
Despite all those reports in the anti-government media talking, you know, spreading these lies about police officers being corrupt and taking money for drug dealers, that's just anti-government propaganda. It's not happening. And you know what, Jim? I would never question the ideas of a police officer. So at first I was kind of opposed to it, but if a cop suggested this, then I have to just, you know, drop the banner like in 1984, and I have to change my position. And I now support this. But
maybe what we're missing is, you know, they're playing the long game, right? Like, you know, we're always, you know, because they have so much, they're so much smarter than we are, they can probably perceive moves like down the game far ahead of what we're thinking of. So maybe this
is the other way. What if it's a sting operation? What if the government is, what if the police have like hired double agents, or maybe maybe they're sending informants into the rehab center to get a mark on their I don't know the drug terminology, but you get what I mean, right?
Yeah, right. It could be like first you sort of lull them into a sense of security, right? Let these hippies know that, hey, you're coming down hard, you need a clean needle, go to the cop, it's going to be cool. Right?
No, so I'm saying, I mean, we all know treatment is a myth, right? Like, we know that the drug people are bad, and that's just the end of it. So if there is a drug treatment facility going on, especially one not run by government, that it's got to be a front for some sort of a drug operation, right? It's got to be something nefarious going on, maybe child prostitution or I don't know, voter fraud. So
or like unleashed peacocks, you know, or, yeah, farming. I don't know what could be going on there.
So what if what we're actually seeing is the police are very wisely sending informants into the treatment center to reveal that that's not what's really going on there?
Well, and to just find more addicts, right? Now, sure, you might have, you know, like these 100 might not be in a jail cell, but that this might put them onto the trail of thousands of addicts that could be put in a jail cell later. So,
oh, and anyone that they call from inside is a potential suspect. On the outside, they could investigate.
Right.
I love so, that. I love the genius of this idea, and I'm surprised that us three mortals even figured it out. It's like hunting over a bait pile, which if I did that while deer hunting, it would be technically illegal here in my state.
Oh, well, but, I've been reading a lot of Tom Clancy.
Oh, okay. Yeah, he writes a lot of pro-government stuff.
Well, I stayed at a Holiday Inn Express, so...
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Now, you did check to make sure that the government inspection certificate was properly displayed in
absolutely.
A conspicuous location. Okay, good.
I checked the signatures, the fingerprints. Yeah, made sure everything was in order. I would never book otherwise.
Yeah. Now, I'm philosophically opposed to this, you know, providing treatment instead of locking up drug users. But because the cops said it, I'm okay with it. I can put aside my philosophical differences.
You just
but
have to trust them.
Yeah. Well, I really love the drug war because what drug use does is it makes people disobedient to government. And... When people start taking the pots or, you know, like snorting the coffee, they have a tendency to become scofflaws and disregard all of our other laws and rules, right. Regulations, declarations, commands, ordinances, orders, you know, things like that. And you just
affiliated court cases, everything.
Yeah. Yeah, and you just don't have a strong, cohesive society with people thinking for themselves. And when you have this disobedience, it's a fundamental moral breakdown of society.
That's the slippery slope that they've warned us about.
Yeah, but even further is, like, on the job, if people are sober, then that means that they can be obedient to their bosses and be really productive. And, you know, I mean... Granted,
well, it's like zombie ants. You guys know about zombie ants, right?
No, I don't.
So there's this fungus that infects ants. So you have to think about like an ant colony. It's perfect, right? It's like a hive mind. Everyone has a job. Everyone gets everything that they need. They just have to like obey the queen, right? And no ant can really accomplish anything by itself. It needs the collective to do anything. So this fungus, this zombie fungus, gets into an ant and it causes it to break from the hive. It causes it to climb high up into a tree because it's thinking independently now. So it climbs up into this tree and then it dies and it releases the spores of the fungus. And so this just shows that like thinking for yourself when you're in a hive, it's dangerous. It could not only kill you, it could kill anyone else that you come in contact with.
I hope the CDC jumps on this and helps those poor ants out.
Well,
I think I've seen this. I think I've heard of this at Grateful Dead concerts where one hippie shows up and spreads a fungus to all the others. And next thing you know, they're all breaking free of the hive. And the results are very unfortunate.
That's scary. So scary. But yeah, I'm going back to the whole work thing. My union supports the war on drugs because when the workers are sober, then they're better able to be combative against the greedy capitalist management in the corporation. So, that's why sobriety is good. Now, granted, the non-union workers, with their sobriety, they're more productive and everything, but that's not really important. It's more important to be bad to the capitalists and love government even more.
Sure.
Well, I know that the Windows Breakers Union are definitely in favor of the war on drugs. A whole half of our mission is combating like urban crime, so it's a big deal.
And what exactly does Windows Breakers Union do?
Oh, well, they break windows. It's the window breaking policy is very delicate. It's very important to break the right windows because if you break a window, first off, that causes economic stimulus because it has to be repaired by the window maker. But the other thing is if there are too many broken windows in a neighborhood, it leads to it leads to crime. It leads to sort of degradation of the society.
You and your brain are listening to Freedom Feens with Michael Dean and his weird friends. My fellow sheep, election season is upon us. Are you one of the 12% of Americans who still approves of our government? Then we need your help to force the other 88% into compliance. Our democracy depends on it. We're an organization called Citizens Against Too Much Unfettered Freedom, or CATMUF. CATMUF is a bipartisan flock of sheep whose goal is expanding government until nothing else remains. Because the government is here to help you. How can you help CATMUF help you? by only voting for candidates dedicated to expanding government. It's easy. You don't need to study the issues. No matter what a politician says when running for office, they're all dedicated to expanding government. And make sure you tell all your friends and family to vote for more government. Here at CatMuff, we don't care if you vote Democrat or Republican, as long as you vote for candidates committed to growing our federal family. CatMuff. Because folks just aren't smart enough to handle real freedom.
The Federal Feens. The worst form of entertainment ever, except for all the others.
And this particular episode goes out to the sick child in the hospital, little Mikey Dean. And if you go to change.org and sign the petition, President Obama will force a celebrity to go visit little Mikey in the hospital. Or maybe he'll just send Joe Biden. But anyway,
I'd rather see Joe Biden than any celebrity. At least Joe Biden, you know, at least he's accomplished something.
Yeah. You know what? Make Harry Reid go with him, too, because Harry Reid is great. And he's a former boxer, too. So he's a celebrity, you know, a celebrity athlete. And, you know, he left that life of being a simpleton behind and became a politician.
Yeah. Well, you know, but Joe Biden, I like Joe Biden because he's a hands-on vice president. You
know? Yes, he is. Yeah. Little Mikey might find that out. Speaking of hands-on celebrities, how about Jared from Subway? But anyway, so yeah, I think we're at the time of the show where we should talk about our favorite political candidates for the 2016 election. And as I mentioned before, I love them all. I love them all equally, but some I love more than others. And I'm really excited by Donald Trump.
What do you
guys think of Donald? The Donald.
I'm very skeptical of Donald Trump because he believes in the free market, and anybody who's been that successful in the private sector, I'm not sure if they can be trusted in the public sector.
Well, there is some redemption then, because he's used eminent domain a number of times to have government take land away from people so that he could have it.
And he's also been involved in numerous bankruptcies. So I think that says a lot to his ability to destroy capital.
Ooh, yeah. And as a matter of fact, that might be a very necessary qualification for the United States eventually. Probably soon.
Right. You want some experience.
Yeah. Now, what I really like about him is he really wants to enforce our immigration laws. Because, I mean, heaven forbid somebody should, like come to America for a better life. I mean, just because that silly statue that we got from France says, you know, give us your tired, your poor, and you know, all that other stuff. You know, I'm just because people came here for a better life way back when, it doesn't mean that people should be doing it now. And what I really love,
well, no, they should be doing it, but they need to go through the proper channels so they can be tagged and numbered and documented so that the revenue can be properly collected from their work. Right?
Right.
What we don't want are people coming in here and not being part of the federal family.
And paying their fair share. And our immigration laws are just like our health care laws, because people have to fill out the paperwork, wait their turn, and follow the process. We can't have undocumented people living here, just like we can't have people going out and getting undocumented health care. And I believe that every good citizen's duty is to snitch on somebody who, you know, goes out and gets undocumented health care and doesn't wait their turn. Just because it's a life-threatening disease doesn't mean that you should, you know, go out on your own. That's just wrong.
Well, and you know what? And Trump has compassion, too, okay? And people say, but he's endorsed mass deportations. He's going to ship out millions of people. But he's also committed to keeping families together. So when he deports one person, he's going to take the whole family and deport them. And I think that shows a kindness that a lot of the other candidates haven't really demonstrated.
Now,
even the possibility of a mass deportation just goes to show the magnitude of the problem.
Yeah. And the problem is we don't have a secure border wall like like East Germany had or East Berlin had,
or North Korea,
or the Soviet Union. I mean, they all took border security seriously.
Yeah,
and they took it so seriously. Their gun turrets pointed outside and inside, and I think ours should too.
Sure,
but you know, with Trump being a businessman, I mean, this is going to be just like, you know, when he was out in the private sector, he's going to use a bunch of government money to build stuff, like namely these big giant walls, you know, like a,
you know,
he's going to put up a 20-foot wall, and then he's going to make 21-foot ladders illegal. But just think of all the people that are going to be getting paid to build these walls, and just think of all the new federal workers that are going to be added to the rolls for the border patrol and other types of groups, and even better, there's going to be a bunch of new pensions later on, so people are going to have all this money in their older years, because you know, I mean, the government pensions are so generous, you know, that way we won't have to worry about people being on poverty in retirement.
Right, that could save Social Security.
I think it's important to point out Hadrian's Wall in ancient Rome. Really, democracy has depended on walls all along.
And I love me some democracy. More Federal Fiends after this trip to the state-run store.
You're listening to Freedom Fiends with Michael Dean and his weird friends, tasing you with liberty since 2011. Learn more at freedomfiends.com.
For some reason in this country, and in most of the Western world, it's okay to just judge.
Hey, this is Michael Dean from the Freedom Fiends radio show. Computer programmer Derek Slopey and I have created Fiend Phone. I'm using Fiend Phone right now to talk with and record one of my co-hosts in real time. Take it, Davi.
Hey, this is Davi Barker, and I'm 1,000 miles away from Michael, but we sound like we're in the same room.
We sure do, Davi. So, Davi, please tell the nice people more about Fiend Phone.
Fiend Phone is free, no-gov software that opens up a global world of possibilities for collaborative, high-quality, remote voice media production, and I'm digging it.
People can try FiendPhone right now at FiendPhone.com, but we're also raising money to vastly improve FiendPhone and vastly improve independent talk media worldwide.
So go to FiendPhone.com to help out. Who will build the audio roads? We will, with your help.
That's FiendPhone.com, FeenPhone.com, Foxtrot, Echo, November, Phone.com.
FiendPhone, I never knew remote audio could be this good.
The Federal Fiends, saying only what we're permitted to say.
All right, it's a going. Before we went to the state-run store, we were talking about our favorite candidates, and we were talking about Trump, and I really love his tough on immigration stance, and I kind of like Dr. Ben Carson for the same reasons, because I saw an article recently that says he wants to deploy drones along the U.S.-Mexico border. So if some family's coming up here trying to get a better life because, you know, Mexico, their government isn't as good as ours and not providing them such a, you know, such a environment to advance themselves, yeah, just blow that family right off the planet Earth. I think that's a great idea.
Well, and Ben Carson also has the idea of mandatory vaccinations. So I like the idea of politicians deciding on what could be injected into every person's body. I think that just makes sense. You know, I kind of like this Ben character.
Yeah.
So well, you guys are bringing up a lot of popular Republicans, but I'm really Hillary man myself, and I realize like they're almost exactly the same, but I think there are some important distinctions to make between Hillary and some of these newcomers, and that's just, you know, she's a legacy candidate. She's run before. She's been sort of the first lady. She's been the Secretary of State. It's really like it's her turn.
Yeah. I think she's great. I was sad that she couldn't get the national health care in back when she was the first lady, and you know, and then, you know, President Obama had to bring it in.
Well, she just wasn't given enough power. That's why I think it's so important to give it to her now.
Why, when you elect a first lady, I mean, she should be given more power. I mean, definitely. So, but what I really like is the example that she's setting for people, because right now the anti-government media is making up lies about her having classified information on her computer, and she's joking about it. Like, you know, she said that she had a Snapchat account, and in the messages erased themselves. And then she made a little comment about, you know, somebody asked if she wiped her server, and she says, "You mean like with the cloth?" And I haven't seen somebody owning and taking, you know, just taking accusations by the horns since George W. Bush at the correspondence dinner was looking underneath this table and said, "Oh, no weapons of mass destruction here." And I think it's great that she's taking it head on. And this should be a lesson to Edward Snowden. He should bring his traitor butt back here and face the music. See, Hillary, she didn't run off to China. She's out there. She's still campaigning, and she's going to be president.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, what else she does that I like? She makes a lot of jokes about bombing countries, and I think that's hilarious. You know,
she should talk to Ben Carson.
There's a great video where somebody asked her about, you know, a possible war with Iran, and it just cracked her up, right? I mean, if we can't have, I mean, we need a president that when they're going around the world bombing everybody in sight, we need somebody that can handle it with a sense of humor, right?
Yeah, definitely. And yeah. Speaking of sense of humor, that laugh that she has is so sexy. Oh my God!
That cackle draws you in. I love it.
It is so sultry, and it's it draws you in. I mean, that's a perfect phrase for it. I mean, when I hear it, I have to put my ear closer to the TV. I wish that I could meet her in person and put my ear closer to her mouth. But yeah, she's awesome. Anybody else that you want to talk about, Davi?
You know, honestly, to tell you the truth, I don't know what Hillary Clinton's policies even are, but I just don't think I care.
Matter.
The other thing is, you know, I don't spend a whole lot of time deciding who to vote for anyway, but she looks presidential to me, I guess is what I mean. And it's time for a woman, for that matter. Maybe if Carla Fiorino. If she runs, maybe she'll split the female vote. Maybe I'll support her.
It's too hard to say the name. It's not going to happen, right?
I personally think Ben Carson has the upper hand, because with President Obama, once you go black, you won't go back.
I've heard that on the radio, or maybe a TV show, I think.
And did I mention mandatory vaccines?
It doesn't matter. Neurosurgeon. I mean, I trust him on anything to do with medicine, because he's a neurosurgeon.
Yeah, I mean, he deals with, you know, epidemiology and all these different things out there. You know, all these different illnesses, all these millions of possible illnesses, he deals with that as a neurosurgeon.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Right? So sounds like he could personally maybe decide what should be injected into every American.
Yeah, right? And maybe those injections could be put on the drones that are killing families on the U.S.-Mexico border to, you know, keep those immigrants out.
Or just like load them into the chemtrail planes and just spray them onto people.
Yeah, even better.
Yeah.
Now, somebody else I really like, and he doesn't get a lot of press, is Marco Rubio. I believe his family is originally from Cuba, and it's not very often that you hear somebody that left Cuba bragging about, you know, liking the progressive income tax. You know, somebody who has left Cuba and still adheres to one of the 10 planks of the Communist Manifesto, I think that's awesome. You know, he didn't assimilate and leave communism behind.
Did he come here legally from Cuba?
Well, I'm sure he did. He's in government. He's a politician. Actually, I think his family came here.
So he's like an anchor baby.
That could be.
Well, if he doesn't win, he could probably Trump will put him in with the mass deportations, because remember, when he's deporting people, he's taking the whole family. So,
yeah, right. And something else, Rubio also supports the sanctions and the embargoes against Cuba, because because these things have been going on for 60 years and Cuba hasn't collapsed yet, I think another 60 years and they're going to fall. Now, I mean, Fidel Castro is almost dead.
Well, you know, someone who was imported from Cuba would be the best person to know what should not be imported from Cuba.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in that Ron Paul character, I mean, he was falsely called an isolationist. I mean, if anybody's a true isolationist, it's Marco Rubio. And that's what I like about him. He's an isolationist. He believes in communism. And, he is like the epitome of the Republican Party. Nationalistic, yeah. Militaristic.
But you know what?
I like what I'm hearing, but I'm not sure about his genitals. I really think it's time for a woman.
Well, and let's go back to Hillary for a second, because we forgot to mention how she said, "I admire Margaret Sanger enormously, her courage, tenacity, her vision." And by Margaret Sanger, we're referring to the famous eugenicists who had these wonderful plans to shape the ethnicity of the world through abortions and selective breeding and sterilizations.
Well, I like that.
Yeah, so, well, I mean, that's vision. That, you want to talk vision? That's vision. Okay.
Yeah, and did she say that the Negro was a weed that needed to be plucked? I'm pretty sure she did.
Said that, or
no, Margaret Sanger. Margaret Sanger.
Margaret Sanger said that.
Yeah, but it was a long time ago.
Are you saying Margaret Sanger smoked the weed?
No. The Negro is the weed that needs to be plucked, meaning the Negroes need to be eradicated, but. Since she said it before segregation was ended, then it was still good, because we all know that laws are good until the exact minute that they're ended. And is not until these laws are repealed that, you know, people, you know, can say that the laws are bad.
You know, even if we disagree with her specific plan to shape the human race, we can still admire her vision and the courage to shape the human race in her design. Okay.
Well, I mean, I think it's really important to combine these ideas with an immigration policy, because I know one of the big concerns with open immigration is that it changes the demographics of the country, and so if you can combine a sort of sound immigration policy with a solid sort of sterilization and eugenics program, maybe you can succeed in bringing in the like labor and tax cattle that you need without changing the demographics.
Or the election outcomes, because it's very important that these new people that come to this country, it's important that they vote. As a matter of fact, if the new people come here and vote, maybe we can get rid of some of the non-voters.
Like start deporting non-voters, because you're obviously, I mean, if you can't even be bothered to help run it, then why should you be allowed to sort of live off the fat of our system?
Yeah, or euthanize them. You know, I just call it a retroactive abortion.
Well, and we already have we could just add that, maybe expand the life panels that we have to just give them a little bit additional authority.
Your voting record could be one of the things considered by the life panel.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, so they'll check out your medical condition, your voting record,
and your Facebook friends.
Yeah, and not just that you voted, but who you voted for, because that's important. Yeah, because I mean, every once in a while you have those renegades out there that try to reduce our government and make it smaller and less effective, and that's really horrible. I mean, these anti-government types out there that, you know, want people to, like, you know, disobey and do their own thing and think for themselves. I mean, it's horrible. It's shameful. I mean, it's dangerous to our democracy.
Well, they should move to Somalia if that's what they want.
Darn right they should. And don't come back. Jim, any thoughts?
Well, you know, I'm just overwhelmed, and I'm just sort of reflecting on the whole democratic process we have and how wonderful it is, and how we have this not just one incredible candidate, like, you know, I mean, you know, we all think like, sure, North Korea is great and everything because they have this one dear leader. We have, we get to pick our dear leader.
Yeah. Now, granted, at this time, there's a lot of choices out there, but over the next couple of months, those choices are going to be whittled down, and the New World Order is going to let us know who our approved choices are. So that's going to make it so much easier.
Oh, yeah. And we already know it's going to be a great choice.
Thank you, New World Order. We'll be right back after this trip to the state-run store.
You're listening to Freedom Feens. Go to freedomfiends.com to help keep it drone-proof.
Whoa. I got my leash in my mouth. This is the Federal Feens, and this is a file segment, and we saved the best segment for last. Because we're going to talk about my favoritest of my favorite candidates, and that is Bernie Sanders. That man is such an economic genius. Nobody else can figure out how to have free health care, free education, free housing, and all this other stuff like Portugal, Italy, Ireland, Spain, or Greece, Spain, Soviet Union and East Germany before they collapsed, North Korea, Communist Venezuela. China. Yeah, Venezuela.
You know, I've been seeing memes on Facebook of Bernie Sanders supporters holding signs that say, "I don't understand economics." And I think that's really the reason to support him is that if you don't understand economics, you should really support someone who does.
Yeah, definitely. As a matter of fact, one of the food lovers in one of those pictures had a sign that says potato. So
well, that's got to be a reference to the famine, right?
No. I think that's a reference to the collective farms and the collective wisdom of democracy.
Yeah, right. And it's also, I think, making a request for the state what he should be stocking in the state food store, right? Mm. Like, I think they're just saying, like, that's what we want to have because, you know, one of the things that Bernie did that, you know, I thought was really bold and innovative. When he revealed the problem with too many deodorant choices. Do you remember that?
Oh, yes.
You know, he's like, hey, this kid's starving, and we've got 26 different kinds of deodorant. A lot of people couldn't make that connection between starving children and too many deodorant choices. That's the genius that we have there, okay?
So, you know, this deodorant thing, this is very personal for me because I don't know if you know this, but there are lots of deodorant companies, but they aren't all stocked in the same store. So I usually do my grocery shopping at Safeway, and I can usually get, I think Tom's is the brand at Safeway, but then if I go over to Trader Joe's, I think, I don't remember which is which. See, this is the thing, I can't even keep it straight. They don't have the same brands. So if I change my grocery store, I de facto change my deodorant, and that means that I have two brands of deodorant in my own house. How am I supposed to decide?
Yeah. Problem solved. You will go to the store and you will buy the deodorant. And best
imagine
of all,
how much more time you'll have to work. Right.
Best of all, it's gender neutral.
Right. Oh, that's good.
Yeah. So there will
flavorless, right?
Yeah. And there will be no trigger warning on your deodorant or no need for a trigger warning. So that's going to be pretty awesome. And yeah. You know what? Something else I like is how Bernie railed against the Federal Reserve Bank. You know, and we know that he had to because, you know, he had to placate some of the people out there that don't believe in central banking. But when it came time for the audit, the Fed bill, he helped to water that down and protect that vital quasi-governmental institution.
It's, you know. Right. He's thinking moves down the board that we can't even imagine.
Right. You know? Right. And you have to remember that a central bank is part of the 10 planks of the Communist Manifesto, just like that progressive income tax that Marco Rubio likes.
Right. Well, it helps to have a country with a big debt, because what that does is it brings the bankers in league with the government. Right.
Yeah. You know, people complain about the scrolling debt number going up, but I don't see it as a debt. I see it as a score.
Well, we owe it to ourselves. And just
it's
as my
investment in yourself.
Yeah. Well, just as my favorite founding father, Alexander Hamilton, said, a national debt is a blessing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. So make it bigger because we need to be more blessed.
Right
it's
on.
A measurement of how much more your government is able to give you than it has. I mean, that's an amazing thing.
Yeah. Right. Could you imagine if love worked that way?
Well, and it's almost proof of divinity when you think about it. It is a miracle. It is a miracle that they can create such wealth out of nothing. It's like creating fish and loaves of bread on demand. Yeah. It's wonderful.
It's bread lines and fish lines.
Yes. Thank you for listening to the Freedom Feens tonight. No, we did not lose our minds. Everything that you heard tonight is an excuse that some bootlicking statist has used in the past. Every last one of those things. Join me this Saturday afternoon with Ben Stone, 1 p.m. Eastern Time, and we will be airing my interview with Adam Kokesh from the Midwest Peace and Liberty Fest. It's a great interview, and I ask him questions that he normally doesn't get. Worms.
Worms.
Worms.